Rooftop solar is one of the big success stories of the energy transition. My home country, Australia, is leading the way here. One in four houses now has solar panels on its roof. When you add up all the rooftop solar in Australia, it is a larger contributor to the grid than any single generator or power station. This has happened partly because of early government support and partly because of successful efforts to reduce permitting time and installation costs. And of course, it helps that Australia is simply a very sunny place. Look at the last year of electricity grid across the eastern electricity grid in Australia. There's plenty of solar power in every single week, even in the middle of winter. So we have it kind of easy in Australia. But what about in Northern Europe, like Germany or Denmark, where I used to live? Having lived there for 5 years, I can tell you that there was a lot more opportunity for windsurfing than sunbaking there. It's generally a dark and windy place compared to Australia. But if you travel through Northern Germany and into Denmark, although the highway is aligned with utility scale wind farms, if you look at the houses, they have solar panels, not wind turbines on them. So why hasn't urban wind taken off like urban solar has? In this video, we're going to talk about some of the reasons why rooftop wind turbines, or urban wind in general, is a way harder challenge than rooftop solar, even in windy, dark places like Denmark. And yes, I will also talk about circumstances where small-scale wind does make sense, and include a few urban wind technologies that you can use if you decide that small-scale wind is for you. And I know from the comments that that is a lot of you. So first up, I want to start with the quality of renewable energy resources that's available on roofs. The quality of a solar resource, or how much sun there is measured in solar irradiation, which on this map is the annual average in kilowatt hours per square meter. To get a good resource, you just need to find a sunny place and then tilt your solar panel so it faces the sun directly. If you're looking to put a solar panel on your roof, you'll need to avoid shading from nearby trees, buildings, or hills, and choose a face of your roof that's close to the optimum tilt angle. And if you can achieve that, you'll end up with a solar resource that is pretty close to what a nearby solar farm would achieve. And if you're in a location with a bad solar resource, say Kolding, Denmark, where I used to live, that has about 930 kilowatt hours per square meter, that is a little less than one half of the power available in a good location, say Canberra, where I live now, which has 2,100 kilowatt hours per square meter. And so you'll get a little less than half of the power from a solar panel in Kolding than you would from the same solar panel in Canberra. Now let's look at wind. The quality of a wind resource is usually assessed by looking at average annual wind speed. Close to Kolding, Denmark, the mean annual wind speed is about 9.5 meters per second at 150 meters above the ground, and 4.3 meters per second at 10 meters above the ground. So in this last sentence, there were two clues as to why we don't see much urban wind. The first clue was where I said the wind speed close to Kolding and not the wind speed in Kolding. And that's because winds in urban areas are slower than in surrounding areas. Tall buildings block the wind and slow it and make it more turbulent. So wind speeds in urban areas are commonly like about 30 to 40% lower than those in the nearby countryside. The second clue was the fact that the wind speed was significantly higher at 150 meters above the ground compared to 10 meters above the ground. And this is because of wind shear. As I mentioned before, wind close to the ground gets slowed by buildings and also by trees and hills and stuff. As you move up and away from these obstacles, there's nothing to slow the wind down, so it's faster. That is one of the main reasons why turbines and wind farms are getting taller and taller towers. A wind farm wind turbine can have a tower height of 150 meters and reach those 9.5 meters per second winds, whereas an urban wind turbine, say on top of a roof or in a backyard, would be closer to the 10 meter height, which sees 5.2 meters per second in open terrain and probably something like 4.3 meters per second in a built up area. So the short urban wind turbine will get wind speeds that are only about 46% of the tall wind farm wind turbine, even when they're really close by each other. And it gets worse because the energy in 4.3 meters per second wind is not even 46% of the energy in 9.5 meters per second wind. In fact, it's less than 10% as much. That's because the power available in wind is related to the cube of the wind speed. There's 525 watts in a 1 meter swept area with 9.5 meters per second wind compared to 50 watts in a 1 meter per second area with 4.3 meters per second wind. So even with a wind turbine of the exact same size, you'll get 10 times less power from the urban wind turbine compared to the utility scale one.
Let's complete our comparison by heading back to Canberra, where the wind speed data gives us 5.6 metres per second at 150 metres and 3.5 metres per second at 10 metres. If we put a wind turbine that sweeps a 1 square metre area on top of a Canberra roof, it would see 3.5 metres per second average wind speed and generate 25.6 watts of power at that wind speed. The Kolding site has an average wind speed of 4.3 metres per second, and the same turbine on a Kolding roof would generate 50 watts of power at that wind speed. And if you could put those towers slightly out of town on 150 metres towers, a 1 square metre turbine would see 5.6 metres per second in Canberra and 9.5 metres per second in Kolding and generate 110 watts in Canberra and 525 watts in Kolding. So those two factors, the reduction in wind speed close to the ground and in urban areas, those two factors combined with the fact that wind power varies with a cube of wind speed make up most of the reason why urban wind does not make as much sense as urban solar. But there are a few other reasons that I'll go into quickly now. Let's stay on the wind and solar resource maps and take a closer look at the Canberra region. The solar irradiation varies from about 1800 kilowatt hours per square meter to 2100 kilowatt hours per square meter. It's basically the same whether I'm on my roof or in the biggest solar farm near the city, the Royalla solar farm. Whereas the average wind speed varies from about 2 meters per second to 10 meters per second. That's about 2 meters per second in the calmest area and around 3.5 meters per second in the parts where most Canberrans live, to over 9 meters per second at 150 meters in the highest wind speed areas, which is basically right where I am now. Surprise, surprise, that's where they installed a wind farm. And I will say that when I left town, I would have said it was basically a windless day, but out here it's pretty windy. Because the wind speed varies a lot and the power depends on the cube of the wind speed, there is a lot more to be gained by picking really good spots to put your wind turbines compared to solar panels, which can go basically anywhere that you've got space for them, as long as they're not shaded.
The next reason I want to look at is the nature of a wind turbine versus a solar panel. Wind turbines rotate, which means moving parts, a certain amount of noise and vibrations, and the wind forces that turn the blades around necessarily cause a large force that the base of the tower has to support. Industrial wind turbines have service technicians doing maintenance and repairs on at least an annual basis, and they have large concrete foundations to resist the thrust loads that are trying to push the turbine over. If you want to put a turbine on top of your roof, then you'll need to make sure that the roof structure can withstand it and all the noise and vibrations will travel into the supporting structure, which sometimes can be a big nuisance. Solar panels, on the other hand, are pretty light, they're silent, they're vibrationless, and they're close to maintenance-free over their lifetime, apart from possibly needing to clean dust or snow off on occasion.
Okay, so that's a bunch of reasons why urban wind doesn't make sense, but I did promise at the start that I would include examples of where it does make sense. So the first and most obviously beneficial situation where you're definitely going to want to install a small wind turbine is off-grid homes or microgrids that need to generate all their power on their own. These sites value a diversity of resources to help spread out the generation between day and night and summer and winter. You can get by with a lot less energy storage or backup diesel generation if you include wind energy, even in a location whose wind resource is not that great. The next place you'd likely want to use smaller urban wind is if you're located in a site that actually does have high wind speeds. So rural properties, like on the coast of Jutland, are one example of this. There are small wind turbines everywhere over there on small farms and rural properties. And I spoke to a couple of farmers who have them and they were thrilled with their performance and money it saved them compared to buying from the grid.
Another place where urban wind might make sense is architectural buildings with wind turbines whose purpose is to inspire or look cool, or any other reason that isn't to actually generate meaningful amounts of reasonably priced electricity. I mean, these buildings are just cool. And I have no doubt that they could have gotten the same amount of renewable energy much cheaper by building a normal large wind turbine somewhere else. But then they could also house the same number of hotel rooms or offices more cheaply just by building a lot of concrete rectangles. There is a place in the world for things that are just cool and for things that inspire people. Finally, if you enjoy DIY or backyard engineering as a hobby and want to learn about wind energy, then an urban wind turbine is a great project for you. I have personally learned so much from small wind energy projects that definitely didn't make any economic sense for the amount of energy generated. And I highly recommend these projects to anyone with an interest in wind energy or engineering in general. So if you fall into one of these categories, then I would like to refer you to this book by Hugh Piggott, And if you're buying a small wind turbine, I would recommend getting it from the list of certified wind turbines whose performance has been validated. A big thank you to the Engineering with Rosie Patreon team who supported this video like all others. If you would like to join us, then there is a link in the description. You can join us on Patreon and on the Discord server to chat about all things renewable energy. We would love to welcome you. I work a lot with wind energy and less with solar power. So for this video, I turned to Brilliant, who are the sponsor of this video, and I did their solar course to brush up on the relevant topics. Brilliant's a website and app with over 60 interactive courses in math, science, and related topics like engineering. I like Brilliant because it lets you learn interactively. It's not about memorizing, it's about doing. And that's what real-world STEM, and especially engineering, is all about. Some of the topics in the solar course are things that I know well from my job as a clean energy expert. Some of it was a reminder of stuff I studied at school, and some of it was brand new. Brilliant has something for all knowledge levels. If you've never studied STEM or if it's been a really long time, then you can go back to basics. And even if you're an expert in closely related fields, there's still something to learn. You can get started for free, and for Engineering with Rosie viewers, Brilliant's offering 20% off an annual subscription for the first 200 viewers to sign up. You just need to go to brilliant.org/engineeringwithrosie. I'll put a link in the description. Thanks, Brilliant, for coming on board as a new sponsor of the channel, and thanks to you for watching. I'll see you in the next video.